When something fits well, it's much more likely to work. And that's true whether you're wearing a bike helmet to protect this resource or growing a winter cover crop to protect and improve the soil. My research journey with cover crops and organic vegetables began in 2001. And after thousands of hours in short and long-term experiments, I'm surprised to say that I began to question if cover crop mixtures of legumes and cereals are well suited for organic vegetable production. Let me give you a little background on these mixtures, and then I'll explain why I question if they're a good fit for organic vegetable production in California. The most common types of cover crop mixtures used in California have 90% legume seed and 10% cereal seed. These mixtures have radically different root systems that can potentially complement each other. The extensive fibrous roots of many cereals, like rye, can quickly capture nitrogen left over from previous vegetable crops and recycle it so that it doesn't leach into the groundwater. In contrast, roots of most legumes can develop nodules, where bacteria can capture nitrogen from the air and convert it into forms that the plant needs. We call this nitrogen fixation. Theoretically, these mixtures would fit well into rotations with organic vegetables because they could potentially reduce the need for expensive organic fertilizers. These fertilizers are commonly used in high-value organic vegetable production systems, primarily to add nitrogen to the soil and ensure high-quality vegetable yields. But here's the problem. At typical seeding rates for cover crop mixtures, weeds grow extremely well and can add huge amounts of weed seed to the soil. We call weed seed in the soil the weed seed bank. It's a spooky thing. And unlike your regular bank, you want your weed seed bank to have a low or zero balance. Because when this weed seed germinates during your next vegetable crop, it can increase weed management costs and therefore reduce profits. This is a major problem in organic vegetable systems, especially in regions like California, where many weed species and vegetables grow year-round, and where hand labor for weeding is becoming more limited. So how do you tackle this weed problem in cover crop mixtures? Well, increasing the cover crop seeding rate to make the cover crop more dense or crowded works really well because high-density cover crops shade the soil quickly, which stunts the weeds and prevents them from producing all those unwanted seeds. Over time, this will reduce the size of the weed seed bank. Unfortunately, the seed costs for a high-density weed-suppressive legume cereal mixture can be nearly 10 times higher than a high-density weed-suppressive pure cereal cover crop. The mixtures are more expensive because they're dominated by relatively large seeded legumes that are more expensive than cereal seed. Because of the large seeded legumes, the mixtures need to be planted at much higher seeding rates than pure cereals to get an adequate cover crop density to suppress weeds. So here's an important question. Are the higher seed costs of these mixtures that are necessary to suppress weeds worth the potential nitrogen benefits from the legumes? For these benefits to occur, the legumes need to thrive and produce large amounts of biomass. But my research over several years has shown that legumes often struggle to compete with cereals and mixtures, and that even when legumes make up 90% of the seed in the mixture, legume biomass is often less than 25% of final cover crop biomass. This has been the case with both legume oat and legume rye mixtures. Several factors can make this situation even worse with the legumes. Given this problem with legume survival and biomass production in mixtures, which in turn limits nitrogen fixation, rather than growing expensive legume cereal mixes, it may be far more cost-effective and environmentally sound to grow a pure cereal cover crop that's really good at recycling nutrients and then purchase organic fertilizers to add nitrogen during the next vegetable crop. But it's important to mention that many common organic fertilizers are made from materials like manure that have high amounts of phosphorus, often far more phosphorus than our crops need. Recent information from long-term experiments in California found that over-fertilization with phosphorus can be a serious problem in some organic systems. Ironically, this brings us back to why it would be great if we could figure out how to efficiently integrate legume cereal mixtures into organic vegetable systems. They could add nitrogen without adding other nutrients like phosphorus that we may not need to add. My suggestion for cover crop management in organic vegetables is to take a long-term systems approach that's focused on frequent cover cropping and weed management. Our long-term research with cover crops and organic vegetables has shown that in terms of soil quality and vegetable yields, frequent cover cropping every year if possible is far more important than whether a legume cereal mixture or non-legume cover crop is used. I only suggest using legume cereal mixes if they're consistent with this long-term approach to frequent cover cropping and weed management. I hope this has helped you to understand the complexity of integrating legume cereal cover crop mixtures with organic vegetable production. There may be times and places where they're a good fit, and others where they're really not. What do you think? Thanks for watching and stay tuned for more exciting sustainable ag research.